Hello YouTubers, welcome to my new video I've created for this blog post. In this video, we are going to extend our existing VGA implementation so we would be able to display frames stored in SDRAM. Now this diagram shows an overview of what you want to achieve. The actual data stored in SDRAM will receive via the XI subsystem, which in turn will store in the FIFO. This FIFO is 32 bits wide, so every element is 32 bits wide, whereas every pixel data is only 16 bit wide, so in effect every element stored in this FIFO contains 2 pixels. So in order to work with the data stored in this FIFO, we first need to split out the individual pixels. This processing is done via 32-bit shift register, which shifts left 16 bits at a time, and we only look at the upper 16 bits. This 16 bits is the pixels we are looking for, which will be storing an asynchronous FIFO. Now, this FIFO will be read one element at a time and will output the pixel data to the VGA screen. The reason why we need this asynchronous FIFO buffer is because we work with two different clock domains. It will be receiving data from the XI end at a rate of about 100 MHz, whereas the VGA screen expects it at a rate of 85.4 MHz. So you need that bit of buffering to overcome the potential cross-clock domain issues like setup and hold violations. Now, if you look at this design, you might be wondering, why am I including 2 separate FIFOs? Can't we just not modify the asynchronous FIFO to do the job of both FIFOs? And the answer to that is, this is because I have get the implementation for this asynchronous FIFO on the internet, and unfortunately it only provides you 2 indicators. One is if the buffer is completely full, then it sends an indication for that, and another one if it's completely empty. Now this implementation will work 100% if you're receiving data at a constant rate. This is, however, not the case with a XI subsystem, which you receive data at a very bursty nature. So you'll receive a bit of data, and then some time will went by when you receive nothing, and then suddenly you receive a number of elements at once. And if you only have a full and an empty indicator, you'll either run into a buffer underflow condition or even a buffer overflow condition. A more suitable FIFO implementation would be if you have some kind of indicator that would indicate if your buffer is halfway full. Then at least you'll overcome this buffer overflow and buffer underflow conditions. And for that, you might think, okay, so can't you just build this in into the asynchronous FIFO buffer? Yeah, one could probably do that, but the thing is, now you have even more functionality that lives on the cross-clock domain, and this would mean more things could go wrong, and in the end, it would be more difficult to debug and troubleshooting cross-clock domain issues can be very frustrating, so it's best to split this functionality to also live within the XI domain. So the key here is just to limit the amount of things that happens in the cross-clock domain. So yeah, that's the reason why I have that the 2 separate FIFOs. Okay. I think we've covered more or less what we want to achieve, so let's get to some implementation details.
Okay, here we are. I've opened up the Vivado IDE and started a new block design. Yeah, so we're ready to start our new design. Okay, so here we have the blank design, and with every ZenQ design, we start off by adding a ZenQ processing block. So here we add it. Can we search for ZenQ, and here it is, ZenQ processing system. So we add that to our block design. Wait it for it to complete. Okay, and here we are. We have designer assistance available, run block automation. So it gives us an invite to do some automation. Okay, I'm gonna accept this assistance. So I click it. Yeah, it pops up this dialogue and you just click OK straight away. Okay, as you can see, two output ports has been connected, DDR and fixed IO. Yeah, the DDR is obviously the external SDRAM and the Zybo board. It has connected. And what we're going to do, our VGA block will need to connect to this DDR. So we're actually gonna channelize all memory requests through this processing system 7 block, which will dispatch it and then on our behalf request DDR and then return it to our VGA DDR block. Alright, I think it's about time we add our own XI block, which we developed in a previous blog post. So let's do that quickly, but before we do that, let's just make this diagram block just a bit bigger so it fills the whole screen and we can see better. Okay, we move this block down a bit. Okay, now it's enough space, so we add our custom XI block. We hit the plus button again and we search for burst. Okay, here's our custom block, my IP burst retest. As I've mentioned, I've developed this in a previous post and I wrapped it in a IP block within the Vivado IDE. And yeah, if you want to know how this is done, you can just reference some of my previous posts where I covered how to wrap within the IP. So let's just add this to our design. Okay, it flipped back to our IDE, but this is usually if you undock that design window which we did earlier. So when you add components to the block design, it will take you back to the main IDE screen. So we just go back to that screen. So here we are. Okay, we just move it a bit. Okay, here you can see this block has a master XI port, and this needs to connect to our processing system 7 block. But as you can see, yes, now every master of XI needs an actual slave, and there's no slave defined here. So we first need to add a slave to our processing system. So let's do that quickly. We do that by double clicking on this processing system 7 block. Okay, let's go to that window that has been created. Oh, here we are. So within this whole dialog box, we click on PSPL configuration and we want to add a GP slave XI interface. The GP stands for general purpose slave XI interface, but that will be more than sufficient for our purposes. So we select this option. We only want one GP slave XR interface port. So that is okay, and we hit okay. Now we go back to our block design. Yeah, and you see here and the slave XI general purpose port has been added to our processing 7 system. And again, here on top you can see designer assistance offered, which we're gonna accept again. Okay, and we just hit okay again, and we wait. Okay, you can see there's a couple of extra blocks now being added to our design, this XI SMC, and here at the bottom you can actually see what it means, XI Smart Connect. So this gets added automatically, so all your XI interfaces, you connect a slave port and it outputs a master XI port, which if I highlight the output, you see it goes to your slave XI general purpose port. So yeah, our custom block has now been connected with our master to the slave of the processing system. And what do we need to do next? Okay, here we see an extra clock input has been added, which is unconnected, so we need to connect this unconnected pin before you can continue. So we do this, we want to connect it to this F clock clock 0. That this will be our clock source for this clock pin, so we add that. Yeah, you can also see now it has been added the clock pin as well to our custom block. So everything is now been added. What we need to add now is our VGA block, which we developed in the previous post, and we did some modifications in this post. So we add a new block and we search for VGA, and here is our block. So we move it down. Okay, let's move it about here. That is fine. So here's all the inputs, and we can start connecting all these inputs. The first one is clock XI, so we're gonna link this up to the general XI clock. So let's do that. This is also this F clock clock 0. We connect that up, and our reset pin. So we want one of our reset pin to reset our system when we power on the FPGA. And a block has already been added that can give us that output. And this is in this RSTPS block. The one we after is this peripheral reset in. Can see there's another one with similar peripheral reset of LTN. So the difference is this one with the circle will reset the system when it's active low. When it's low, it will reset the system. But if you need some peripherals that needs a positive reset, you'll use this peripheral reset of LTN. But for now, we want this one of the circle to correspond to this one that's also a circle. So let us connect them up. And here we are. Now what do we need to connect up next? Let's quickly go through all the inputs. Okay, we have this IP2 bus MSTRD. This is part of our XI interface, which we need to connect to our custom interface. And you'll see here in our custom interface, we have a port been named similar. Here we are, bus 2 IP MSTRD underscore D. So this is the one we need to connect to this pin. So we connect them up. Similar, this one IP2 bus outputs. There's also an IP2 bus output, so we connect them together. Here we are. Number one, IP2 MST address. Now this is an output, so we need to connect it to an input in our custom AXI block. So here is the similar one, IP2 bus MST address. So we connect them up. Okay, here we are, and similarly IP2 bus MST length, and here's the length, so we connect them up. And this one, the inputs, we also connect together. Yeah, it's taking shape now. We can see our custom AXI block has about all its inputs connected except for this AXI init, AXI TXN, and AXI TXN done, and AXI error. But we don't need to worry about those inputs. But there's still a couple of pins on our VGA block which is not connected, which should be. And one important one is this clock. So we already have a clock XI which is clocking to our XI clock speed, but we have also an additional clock input that will be our pixel clock, clocking at 85.4 megahertz. This is the generating the dots that we will get display on our VGA screen. So in order to generate that, because this XI1 is clocking at 100 megahertz, so we need something to generate 85.4 megahertz one, and to do that we add the clock wizard block. So let's go and add one, and we search for clock, and here's our clocking wizard, and we wait for it to be added. And here's our clock wizard block. So I'll just drag it down over here. Okay, that's fine. And let's connect up the pins quickly. The clock input is obviously our XI clock source, so we connect that up. So this is our input clock for our clock block. And the reset pin we connect to a peripheral reset pin. You see now we again use the reset pin on this RST block. This is not a negative one, but a positive one. So that's connected. And yeah, this is the clock out, and this we actually need to connect to the clock in of our VGA block. We connect that up, but we still not finished with our clock wizard block. We need to do some extra configuration, so we double click on this clock wizard block. Okay, here is our configuration screen. A couple of important things we need to check. So you can see there's a couple of tabs here, but the only one we are really interested is the clocking options and the clocking output clocks. So we first go to the clocking options, and here we just need to double check on the input frequency. This frequency must always be 100 megahertz within this context of a Zybo board. I've actually encountered something in the while I was playing with this, for one or other reason it got set to 150 megahertz, and that caused some very strange issues. Like every time when I connected my Zybo board to the VGA screen, it complained about not optimum resolution, and after a whole battle eventually found that that was due to this frequency not being set to 100 megahertz. So when you're doing design, it's probably a good idea just to double check every now and again, especially before you start synthesizing your design and generating the bitstream. Before you do that, you just double check if this frequency is 100 megahertz. So this is one check you need to do. And let's just go to the output clocks tab. Here we're actually going to set the output frequency, which will be the dot clock frequency of our VGA block. So we specify here a value of 85.4. This is more or less the frequency that my LCD monitor expects to work properly. So I specify that and I just double check the summary here. We check a couple of things. The input clock frequency is 100 megahertz, so that is fine. This is about it. So we confirm that changes. So yeah, we've now connected up eventually the clock pin to our VGA block, but we still have a couple of remaining pins that's not connected yet, and these are the vertical sync, the horizontal sync, red, green, blue, and all these signals is actually supposed to go to our VGA connector on the Zybo board, so it can get displayed on our VGA screen. So we need one other way to route all these signals to the right place. So in order to do that, we will need to make use of a constraints file. But before we look at the contents of a constraint file, let's just have a look a bit on how the pin layout looks like on a FPGA. You'll see a picture now appearing on the screen with a couple of chips, and one I'm interested is actually the picture at the bottom right. This is more or less how the ZenQ chip will look on the bottom, which is it's a square matrix full of pins. And we actually need to specify within our Vivado IDE which pin needs to receive signals from our FPGA design. So in order to do that, we specify it in a very similar way as you would the notation you typically use in a chess game. To make my statement a bit clearer, this picture on the screen will typically look like a layout of a chessboard where you had a column on the left has been numbered, and as well as the top row. So it's almost like a chessboard, but there is a couple of differences. The column and a row has been swapped around. Here we actually numbering the rows with alphabet letters, and your columns you're actually numbering with numbers. These will aid you actually in specifying a specific pin to the Vivado IDE. So I think we have about more or less enough info now to have a look at how a constraints file looks like. So let's open up the constraints file in this project. So we go here at sources, okay, I'm actually looking for the constraints file, and here we are, VGA const XDC. Yeah, I must actually tell you, I haven't wrote this file from scratch. You can actually get this on a GitHub site maintained by Digilint, and that's the the maker of the Zybo board, and they make it available on GitHub, so you can just copy and paste whatever you need. So let's quickly go through this. Every pin has a set of entries, and the important thing here is get ports. We actually give it a name, in this case VGAR_R, which is actually VGA RED. This is part of the RED component of the VGA video signal, as well as a subscript. So since this is a 16-bit color output, it's arranged in a way that for red you have 5 bits, for green you have 6 bits, and for blue 5 bits as well. So this is what this subscripts mean. You have a couple of reds, VGA red 0, VGA red 1, 2, 3, 4. So we go from 0 to 4, so this is the 5. So we have 5 inputs for the red channel, and here we start with the green ones. So you have green 0, green 1, green 2, green 3, green 4, green 5. So you have a total of 6 pins for the 6 bits of the green channel. And we have the blue, so the blue 0, blue 1, blue 2, blue 3, and blue 4. So and we end off with the last two namings of VGA-HS. This is for the VGA horizontal synchronization pin. So yeah, every time when you reach the end of the line, the horizontal synchronization signal gets triggered, and your monitor keeps in track with where it should be on the screen, as well as the vertical synchronization. So this is a specification for that. Okay, let's go in a bit further detail. Here we define the actual pin that we want to assign on the bottom of the FPGA. This is the package pin N19. So this means this named port will be for the pin located at row N and column 19. So we use our semi-chess notation again. And here we just define an additional property for that name port, IO standard LV's CMOS 33, at 33 stands for 3.3 volts. So this basically what those definitions mean. So for the other ports you have similar ones, like the VGA RED 1 will be located at row L and column 20, and VGA RED 2 is row J, column 20, and so on. So this is basically what your constraints definition do. With this, you've now created a named port, and to tell it which pin on the actual FPGA it will be using. So now we need to add this named port to our design. So let's go back to our design. I'm just going back to this diagram and just gonna undock it again from our IDE. Alright, so you add a port in this block design. Let's just move right here, and so we create a couple of ports, so it's aligned on top of each other. So the first one is the VGA RED. So you do this by right clicking and selecting create port, and we call it VGA_RED. So this is exactly the named port. I actually have the constraints will open at the back, which is actually cool. I can see VGA_R, and we have VGA_R and direction. Say is this going to receive a signal or going to send one? We want to send the signal to this VGA RED port, so we're going to specify it as an output. And we check this option create vector, since this signal is not a single bit, but but actually 5 bits. So we say we number it from 4 to 0. So we say okay, let's go back to our block design. Yeah, here it's been added. Now let's add one for the green one. So it's VGA underscore G for green, output, create vector. For green we have more bits, so it's a 5 instead of a 4. So we add that and we look again. So here we have 4, 5, and now we red, green, blue, we add one for blue. VGAB, it's an output, grand vector, and this one is 5 bits again. It's 4. Look at the design. Let's just move it a bit so it looks better on the screen. Okay, looks okay. So 4, 5, 4. That it's 5 bits, 6 bits, and again 5 bits. We still need 2 more for the horizontal synchronization and the vertical synchronization, so let's add them as well. Create port, so it's VGA, VS, output. Oh yeah, this one is only going to be a single bit, so you'll not need to check this create vector checkbox. So you add it like that. So the VS, and you add one for the horizontal one. Wrong option. Create port, VGA, HS. Outputs. Okay, I think that is about everything. VGA red, green, blue, vertical synchronization and horizontal synchronization. These we need to link up. So we say red to red. Something went wrong here. Let's just try this again. Red, green to green, blue to blue, and vertical sync to this port, and horizontal sync to this port. Okay, starts looking like we almost connected everything. I think let's just double check now all our connections to see if we've covered everything. So we can just clock here around. So this clock is been connected to a clock out, that's right. The clock XI is connected to F clock, that's also fine. The reset is connected to reset in, that's fine. MS bus MSRT. It's connected to the data one, that's fine. Outputs 5, 0, that's fine. See the vertical sync. It's connected to the vertical sync. Horizontal sync is to the horizontal sync. Red is to red, green is to green. Blue is to blue. Let's see this address. Yeah, it's connected to address. Length is connected to length. And inputs is connected to inputs. Yeah, I think this is both connections for this one and this one. And the clock is also connected up. Let's just double check to see if our input frequency is still specified at 100 MHz. Okay, that's fine. Yeah, I think our block design is now finished. What we need to do now is to start the synthesizing our design. So we do that by first, okay, let's just dock our window again to the IDE. Okay, that's fine. And we save our design. And we use this option, run synthesis. So we click that. Rerunning synthesis will result in resynthing implementation and removing all the results files. Okay to proceed? Yes, we can proceed. The another dialog box. So for this we also just click OK. And now we wait a bit. Okay, this takes a bit of time, but usually shortly after you kicked off the synthesizing process, it will give you a prompt that you need to first accept, and then it will go on. Okay, here it continues. It looks it's going fast now. Okay, yes, it launch critical messages once in a while. Get this thing, these critical messages, but in this design, don't really need to worry about them. So just click OK. Yeah, and here you see actually starts synthesizing design. So I think I'm just going to fast forward the video till we get to the finished dialogue. Our synthesis is completed. Okay, don't need this other option, so we're just gonna hit cancel, and it's now time to actually start our bitstream generation. So we move down and we select generate bitstream. Just say yes and okay. We wait a bit. Yeah, and here on top you see our process has just started. So this is also a long process, so let's fast forward the video again. Okay, our bitstream generation has just completed, so yeah, let's go forth and test out our design. So hit cancel, and now we actually need to open up our SDK, which will program our ZenQ with a Hello World program. So this is usually you need to run one or other program to get the things working. So let's quickly do that. So we start off clicking File, Export Hardware, Include Bitstream. So here we actually take the generated bitstream file and we move it to a SDK project. Okay, and now we launch SDK. We say okay. Okay, here's SDK software development kit. We wait for it to open up. Okay, yes, it has opened up. Let's just make it full screen. We wait for it to do all its prior initialization. I think I'm going to fast forward this process a bit. And here we are. So let's create that Hello World project. So we say, oh, by the way, this is very similar to the Eclipse environment. So you have a workspace with a couple of projects. So we're going to create a new one with the Hello World project. So we say file application project. And we just call it test. Say next. Yeah, Hello World. Let's say hello in C. We click finish. And our project is created. It's here, it says test with the C. So if we open this up, the source, let's see here. Oh yeah, I was just missing some stuff now. That what I need to trigger up, but I just see the debug appears here, which I actually need. So yeah, let's fire off this program in debug mode. So I'm just gonna connect the Zyber board to the USB port. Just okay, the light has just gone on. And yeah, first we need to program it. Just wanna get the camera quickly up so I can just show you people how what happens when you program the device. It's a bit dark here, but you can see, make out more or less, here is a red light. So I'm just gonna trigger the programming of the device. Okay. Say program. Wait, yeah, you see it has been programmed and the green light turned on. So this is more or less when you program the device, this is more or less how it looks like. Next up, we should find it Hello World program. Currently there's nothing on the screen, so once you fire off the Hello World program, you will actually see something on the screen. So let's do that quickly. So debug as launch on hardware system debugger. We want to open this perspective now. Yes. And yeah, our debugging of our project have started. Next, let me show you what the screen looks like. Sorry if the sound now sounds a bit muffled, but I've just closed the lid. The monitor's actually behind the laptop. So I need to close it to get a screenshot. So here is more or less how it looks like. It actually looks like these old analog TVs. If you pull out the aerial antenna, and you see these flags on the screen. The funny thing though, I know it's reading this from memory, and you expect some and you actually expect something randomly displayed, but it should be static landscape, but this thing is moving, so something is not like. So let's do some investigation.
This concludes this video. We'll cover the actual investigations mentioned at the end of this video in the next blog post. Hope you've enjoyed the video. Thanks for watching.